It's the last one of a series of a national commission on ICE misconduct, on misconduct by the Immigration Customs and Enforcement Agency, and how they have been violating all of our community's rights, our civil rights, our constitutional rights, not just of undocumented immigrants. Again, the way that immigration raids are happening today, they are happening on, they're detaining U.S. citizens, lawful permanent residents, people with work authorization, and undocumented immigrants, completely violating their rights. So please join us. It's a public hearing. There will be speakers, both women and workers, men and women who were detained during these raids, and this will be at the end of this hearing. One of the unions, the United Food and Commercial Workers Union, will be putting together a report to Congress denouncing these violations. And so we invite all of you, and if any of you want to share testimony, please talk to me afterwards and we can figure out how to include you in the hearing as well. Thank you.
Hi, good morning. Again, my name is Joanne Lee, and I'm with the Legal Aid Foundation of Los Angeles. I'm also a board member of the Korean Resource Center. And I'm going to be talking about human trafficking and slavery, mostly in the context of the United States and the workers that are trafficked in the United States, and how to identify them, some of the outreach that we're doing, and what the laws are. So these are our objectives for today. We're going to talk about the definition and scope of trafficking, how the identification and outreach, and the U.S. law. So these are some questions that hopefully you'll be able to answer by the end of the session. Are these true or are they myths? So I'm going to let you think about it and move on because I don't have that much time. So first, the definition and scope. According to the U.S. Department of Justice, no state or territory is immune to human trafficking. So these are just some statistics for the U.S. as well as globally. Every year in the U.S., 16 to 18,000 men, women, and children are trafficked into the U.S. 800,000 people are trafficked across national borders. 12.3 million are forced into labor, bonded labor, or child labor and sexual servitude at any given time. Other estimates are at anywhere between 4 and 27 million. 80% of transnational victims are women and girls, and up to 50% are minors. The thing about the statistics for trafficking is that nobody really knows what the numbers are. It was interesting because when some of the trafficking laws first passed in 2000, the State Department estimated that there were 50,000 individuals trafficked into the United States every year. For some reason, the numbers have slowly gone down. I think it's an issue of identification and outreach, but because the issue is so hidden and so invisible, it's impossible to know exactly what the numbers are. So in the United States, this is how we define a victim of trafficking: any person forced to work or engage in commercial sex, and any child induced to engage in commercial sex. So in the first bullet point, there's an element of force, fraud, or coercion that has to be present. And then if you're a child, if you're under 18, if you're working in the commercial sex industry, by definition, you're considered a trafficking victim. So setting the stage, what are some of the things that lead to trafficking? And this was alluded to in some of the previous presentations, but there is an economic sort of push and pull factor, political and other social factors, economic disparity, high unemployment, disruption of traditional livelihoods, discrimination in the home countries, personal reasons, civil unrest. There's many factors that lead to why trafficking occurs. The recruitment can be global. So there's a lot of people recruited from different countries to come here. And then there's also internal trafficking, where there are many individuals, vulnerable individuals, already in the United States, documented or undocumented, who are preyed upon by individuals who exploit their labor. Just to give you an example, in Korea, we have a lot of clients who are trafficked from Korea, and it's a very, very intricate system of trafficking. There are individuals in Korea recruiting folks. They tell them to get their passports made, that everything will be taken care of, that they will have good work opportunities in the United States. They meet them at the airport. They put them on the plane. They usually fly to Canada or Mexico. There's another person here who meets them at the airport. They're handed off to another person who drives them across the border. Then they're handed off to another person who's going to integrate them into the industry where they're going to work. So according to some of the law enforcement individuals that we work with, Korea has one of the most intricate and difficult to track systems because the brokers are so well organized. So it's been very challenging. Like I said, who are the traffickers? They could be crime rings and networks, various employers, government officials. We've had cases where diplomats bring their maids, other workers with them to this country, and then they're exploited for their labor. Family members. We've had domestic servitude cases where people bring over their spouses, their wives, and then they're isolated and trapped into a trafficking situation. So one of the things that we've been working on is identification and outreach. And these are some of the things to look for. How are the trafficking victims entering the United States? Some of them have travel documents. They could be legitimate and they could be fraudulent. And then many also enter without inspection, which means they don't have documents and they're usually brought in through Mexico or Canada. One red flag to identify a trafficking case is if the employer confiscates the passport. It's very common. Although a lot of traffickers have seen that that's one thing that law enforcement looks for, that the passports are confiscated, so they're now letting a lot of the trafficking victims keep their passports so that they won't be considered trafficked. So the traffickers are very smart, and they change according to how much law enforcement is how smart law enforcement is becoming in identifying victims, and they're changing their tactics. So is smuggling and trafficking the same? Many people are confuse these two terms. Smuggling is facilitating the illegal crossing of a non-citizen into the U.S., and trafficking is the use of force, fraud, or coercion for forced labor or commercial sex. So there are two different things. If you're smuggled into the U.S. and you're not forced to work, then you won't be considered a trafficking victim. And you can also be considered a trafficking victim even if you're not smuggled into the U.S. So if you're here already and then you're put into a trafficking situation, you could be considered a trafficking victim. So these are some places where to look, where you might be able to find trafficking victims. And again, like I said, we don't know the full picture. There might be many other industries where trafficking victims can be found. These are some ways, some places that we've also looked, to try to find victims. Sometimes they're allowed to go to markets, English classes, spas and saunas, cosmetic stores, beauty and nail salons. We often find victims at in the jails after they're arrested, sometimes for prostitution in the courthouse. Law enforcement also refers a lot of victims to us, and we've also found some victims through the ethnic media. We've had clients who call local radio stations or newspapers and seek help. These are the different forms of victim control. It doesn't have to be physical. There doesn't have to be a lock on the door or chains on the windows. It could be psychological. Many times they're threatened that they will be harmed, their families will be harmed. They're told that they can't go outside because the police are streaming the streets and they will be picked up and arrested. So there's many different ways that victims can be controlled. Just because they can maybe walk out the door doesn't mean that they're not a victim. I'm actually told that I'm out of time, so I'm going to go very quickly through just a few slides. This is an example. This is a picture that I found in a State Department report. Is this trafficking? This is a banner that was in Korea. This is a big problem in other countries as well as the U.S. of bringing brides over basically to be domestic servants and sexual slaves. We've also engaged in a campaign. The issue of outreach is a big concern within the government. People are concerned that the numbers are not as high as estimated, and so there's a lot of funding going into outreach. I've brought some of these posters. They're outside, so if any of you are business owners or come into contact with individuals you suspect may be trafficking victims, I encourage you to take these and put them up in public places. We also have these comic strips that we've developed that kind of give a story and hopefully will help identify trafficking victims. The U.S. law has offered some protections for victims of trafficking. The purpose is to obviously prosecute traffickers, to protect victims, and then to prevent it from happening. These are some things that we assist with. A lot of legal services organizations assist with helping victims get social services. We help them report to law enforcement. We help them obtain immigration status, obtain government benefits, get some kind of legal representation in civil matters as well as their immigration matters. And if they want to go back to their home countries, we can also help with repatriation. I think I'm gonna just wrap up. These are some, the T visa is a visa that was created in 2000. There have been a lot of issues with the implementation of the law, but these are the basic requirements to obtain a T visa. You have to be present in the US, you have to show that you're a victim, you have to assist law enforcement, which has been the most difficult requirement for many of our clients, and then you have to show that you would face extreme hardship if returned to the home country. These are some statistics of how many have gotten T visas, and as you can see, the numbers are very small in comparison to the numbers I showed earlier of how many victims there are in the United States, which is another reason that we need to do more outreach and identification. And then finally, just some thoughts on whether this is enough. It's been incredibly difficult to provide all the support that is needed to the trafficking survivors because of a lack of resources. There aren't enough shelters, there's not enough funding, there's not enough services out there. There is a huge lack of understanding of the culture of trafficking. Law enforcement does not know how to properly identify trafficking cases, and the law is not properly implemented, and it's weak in many areas. So. I'm sorry to rush through this, but hopefully you got a picture of the issues facing trafficking in the U.S., and you can help us identify and assist the survivors of trafficking. Thank you.
I think we have about 5 minutes for questions, and I wanted to first of all mention that Joanne will be, even though she's not listed in the program book, one of the speakers or resource people in the following workshop on immigration. So particularly when it comes to trafficking and the questions related to her presentation, if you don't get a chance to ask it now, you can ask it during the workshop. And while I'm waiting to see if anyone has a question, I actually wanted to ask Maria Elena to do a quick sort of update on the situation for the guest workers who are on hunger strike in D.C. Two of us were there actually 2 days ago, and we went to meet with some of the workers. Maybe you can talk a little bit more about that situation from Mississippi and Texas.
Thank you, Unsuk. So the situation that UNSUC is referring to is a group of about 500 workers from India that were brought over on H-2B visas to work in Mississippi after Hurricane Katrina. And they were basically victims of human trafficking. They paid about $20,000 to come to the United States. They had been promised green cards by the labor recruiters in India, and they were told that within a month or two they would be able to bring their families over as well. Unfortunately, when they arrived in Mississippi, they found that they did not have green cards. They only had a temporary H-2B visa for 10 months and began facing extreme levels of exploitation. There were about 24 men living in one trailer, and they were being $1,050 was being deducted from their paychecks to pay for that living conditions. And to make a long story short, they have filed claims. They all walked off the job, meaning that because their visa status is tied to that employer, once they quit, they're now undocumented. And they walked from New Orleans to Washington, D.C. to raise concerns and talk to Congress. They've filed complaints with the Department of Justice, the FBI, and the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission has been investigating their case. However, they have not been able to get any responses from the Department of Justice. And on May 14th, they began a hunger strike in Washington, D.C. And they're asking for continued presence, which would allow them legal status and work authorization while the government investigates their case. They simply want to cooperate with the government, but they need some kind of protection because now they are undocumented and they are afraid that they will be picked up by immigration and deported. So we actually have, from the event that UNSUC and I were at in Washington, D.C., we have a petition that explains some more details about the case, and they have asked for people all over the country to please sign the petition that they will then be presenting to the Department of Justice and members of Congress. So, again, I'll be in the workshop on immigrant workers. If people want more details, I can provide them there. And I also have a couple, only five reports that I brought with me, a report that we wrote about the conditions in the Gulf Coast after Hurricane Katrina, if any of you are interested.
Even though we have 5 minutes, we still want our speakers to be comfortable. If there's any other questions, yes, Cynthia?
The mic coming to you. Hi, my name is Cynthia. I work with the Coalition for Humane Immigrant Rights of Los Angeles. My question is for Jean. Because part of the issues that we're talking about within the immigrant rights community is looking at the root causes of migration, and that an isolationist U.S. immigration policy, whether it's a reform policy or not, isn't really going to be useful if it doesn't address that root causes part. And so my question is the Institute looking at research on the migratory side effects of the United States foreign economic and development policies and how it's really helped induce a lot of these huge migration flows around the world? Thank you.
Hello. Thank you for the question. Yes, our institute is sees the way we see the next wave of immigration reform is not only dealing with how the immigration reform should be restructured within the country, but how to bring the sending countries into the conversation and how to make sure that the root causes of why people leave. Particularly from Latin America, because the majority of immigrants who come to the United States are from Latin America, how to help the countries to develop so there is no so much pressure for the migrants to leave and come here. Many come undocumented, without documents, and that's a big issue in addressing the current presence of undocumented immigrants is to help those future migrants to stay home, to have decent jobs, and not not seek the entrance without proper documentation. So it's the close cooperation with Mexican and other Latin American countries. And that's, again, this is a position of our institute. Unfortunately, that's not a position of the U.S. government, which sees immigration as a domestic issue and wants to have a control over it only from a domestic point of view, and we think it's a limited view on a phenomenon such as international migration.
If any other speakers would like to comment on that question, otherwise, if there's one more question, yes.
I'm in Lee, LA City anti-trafficking member. Anyway, how many Korean women in LA, according to the anti-trafficking? And then another one is one lady came from Chicago, I think. Out of a sanctuary, came here to demonstrate, and then police arrested her, and then she released the next day in an immigration office, sent them back to Mexico. What happened to her? Such a big news, but we don't hear anything.
First, we'll have Joanne answer the question on trafficking. I think maybe Maria Elena could ask this question about Elvira Arellano.
The question was how many Korean women are trafficked into Los Angeles. And like I said before, I think that number is very, very difficult to quantify. A large percentage of our clients have been Korean women. However, unfortunately, I think the law enforcement, they do not properly identify trafficking victims. A couple of years ago, there was a big raid in Los Angeles where there were many, I think 40 or 50 Korean women who were picked up, and they were labeled as material witnesses, and we tried to work with law enforcement to interview them and to screen them to see if they were trafficked, and law enforcement was not very cooperative. We actually went into the jails and tried to interview them, and we actually did identify many of them to be victims, but we just could not get access to them, and because of the culture of trafficking, many of them ended up just going back into the trafficking situation. So I think that's a really good question and something we really need to examine. I think that the problem is huge. And so that's one of the reasons why we are trying to do a lot of outreach and identification.
And I think you were mentioning Elvira Arellano, who is the woman from Mexico that was in, she had been in sanctuary at a church in Chicago and then came here and was deported. She is back in Mexico with her son. She was reunited with her U.S. citizen child. She continues to be very active from Mexico, very involved in supporting immigrant rights activists here in the United States. Similar to Elvira, however, there are a number of other families, we don't know how many either, that are in churches that have given them refuge. There is actually a growing national sanctuary movement where churches all over the country are providing a safe space, a safe harbor for immigrant families that are in deportation proceedings. Right now, we know that there are about 15 families, but there probably are many more than that that we will not know the exact numbers because of the fear of deportation. In Iowa, as you may have heard, just last week or 2 weeks ago now, there was a big raid, the largest raid in one plant that immigration did, and they came with criminal arrest warrants for about almost 400 workers. As a result of that raid, there were about 200 workers that also sought the refuge of a church because they were afraid that they also were going to be picked up by immigration. So this is a grave concern. Elvira Arellano was the leader. Leadership in that movement, but there are many, many people seeking that type of refuge.
If there are any more questions, if not, we wanted to thank the panelists here for this presentation, and I'm going to give it back to the MCs. Thank you.
Thank you. At this time, everyone's going to break up into their respective workshops. Like we said, workshop one will cover the history of progressive Korean American movement, which is a continuation of the first panel discussion that we had. Workshop two will discuss the U.S. immigration policy and worker rights. And workshop three will cover Korea after People's Uprising. All of the information on workshops are contained in your booklets, and the room assignments are outside the door if you step out.
Okay. 지금까지 이어진 주제 발표를 기본으로 저희가 분과 토론회를 세 개 마련했습니다. 첫 번째 분과 토론회는 진보적 해외 운동의 역사, 두 번째 분과 토론회는 미국의 이민 정책과 노동자의 권리, 세 번째 분과 토론회는 5.18 광주 민중 항쟁 이후의 한국이라는 주제를 가지고 분과 토론이 이어지겠고요. 분과 토론회 방에 관련한 안내는 러비에 나가시면 있습니다. 분과 토론이 끝난 다음에
조금 점심시간이 늦어졌지만 끝난 다음에 점심시간이 이어지겠습니다.
We're a little bit behind schedule, but after workshops, you'll be led to the cafeteria for lunch, and afterwards, we'll gather back here for the afternoon session. Very, very special performer here. He has been an active organizer in downtown LA since age 12. Since then, he has been speaking to various audiences regarding youth activism and organizing. And today, he'll be giving a cultural performance through poetry and spoken word. Please welcome Jean-Eric Concordia.
How's everybody doing? This is Sai. He's our guitarist for our band, and we're gonna try our best to give you a little something. Wanna thank everybody for coming out. You know, warm international solidarity, militant greetings from KMB and the organizations that we're involved with, and also as artists, we hope that everybody is here learning a lot of stuff regarding immigrant rights issues, and other than that, I guess we should get started. So. Stop the presses! Here comes an important message brought to you by your friendly neighborhood representative. For your own safety, we're gonna go out and safely gather all the terrorists hiding near your homes lately. But we'll be needing your assistance. Snitch on any suggesting resistance. They might be your next door neighbor, for instance. A couple of colored folks not speaking English. Asian, Arab, African, no need to distinguish. Give us a call and we'll make sure they never bother y'all. Put them all behind a tall wall. Go back to your malls. And make sure you pick up on the latest fashion trends. Newest clothes, hot gadgets, well, as long as you spend and continue to send immigrants to the pen. You couldn't possibly be racist because you have black friends. So let us know where they're at. Matter of fact, help them pack under the Immigrant Act. These colors ain't coming back. So let us know where they're at. Matter of fact, help them pack under the Patriot Act. These colors ain't coming back. So let us know where they're at. Matter of fact, help them pack under the Patriot Act. Your ass ain't coming back.
Things would be okay.
day. Peace of mind as simple as a breath away. With him by my side, you know we'll find a way. And if there's no tomorrow, what we do today, things will be okay. Things will be okay. Things will be okay. And things will be okay.
Understand what is happening not only here in the United States, not only here in LA or in Koreatown, but what's happening in Africa, what is happening in the Philippines, what is happening in the Middle East, what is happening in South America and all over the world as we struggle for resources. We're immigrants. We've left our land because for some reason or another, the resources that are in our homeland has left. And sometimes it's hard for us to continue to keep the good fight going. Hopefully, we'll keep fighting. Gasping for
bees tonight and the men they made of. Doesn't matter as you lose yourself, been hustled by your hustle. If you can no longer see tomorrow, gone farewell, it's left you hollow. As night swallows you to sleep, forget what you saw. It'd be best you don't exist. Your answer thought a whispered wish, that single strand of hope. You hope you lose your grip. It's hard to block it out as things around you proves without a doubt your whole existence can be extinguished, and no one here misses out. I'm drowning, but I just can't get up. As I'm gasping for a little quick breath before my body gives up. Living life prepared to die, tell my mama don't wait up. Because I'm battling the beast tonight and the men they made up. The people united will never be defeated. El pueblo unido jamás será vencido.
Thank you for the wonderful performance. Okay,
이제 오후 시간을 다시 개회해 주실 분을 소개해 드리겠습니다. 이분은 존 돌로로시고요. 현재 UCLA 개공 교수로 계시면서 Dolores Faltas Labor 연구 노동센터의 디렉터로 계십니다. 그리고 또 이분은 전 SEIU 노조 조직 활동가로 활동하셨으면서 또 아시아 태평양 아메리칸 노동연합 아팔라 회장도 역임하셨던 분이십니다.
Now we'll go on to the next part of the program. We have a very important speaker, John Doloro, who is currently an executive director of the Dolores Huerta Labor Institute and also visiting lecturer at UCLA, where he teaches leadership development and strategy in Asian American communities. Mr. Doloro was the manager of the Southwest California area of the 90,000 SEIU local, 10,000, and he is also recently served as the president of the LA chapter of the Asian Pacific American Labor Alliance. Mr. Doloro.
I don't like podiums. I feel very separate from everyone when I stand behind one. Just to introduce myself, my name is John Doloro. I'm the executive director of the Dolores Huerta Labor Institute. The Dolores Huerta Labor Institute is the educational partnership between the Los Angeles labor movement and the nine college LA Community College District, which covers about 130,000 students in the LA area. majority being working students, the future of Los Angeles working people. And actually, I wanted to start off today with just a very short story, a historical story. It's the story of the origin, actually, of citizenship in the U.S. In 1741, in New York, before the U.S. was a country and still a colony of Great Britain, there were a whole slew of buildings that started to mysteriously burn down. And one day, one night, someone was able to burn down the governor's mansion. And so the colonial government started freaking out, saying, "Who is burning our buildings down?" And one night, they actually caught a person fleeing from the scene, this young Irish immigrant woman. And they caught her. And they asked her, they interrogated her, and they found out that there was this group of African slaves and Irish indentured immigrant workers who formed an alliance to seize the government. And they had planned on burning the buildings down and taking power. Now, the conspiracy was revealed, and they arrested more than half of the African-American population in New York. They arrested a large number of Irish immigrants. They threw them into separate cells. And then they went and met with the African slaves. And they asked the African slaves, "What were you planning on doing when you have taken power?" And the African slaves said, having nothing to lose, "Kill all the whites." Then they went to the Irish immigrants and they asked them, "What were you planning on doing when you were going to take power?" And the Irish immigrants said, "Kill all the whites." Now, these Irish immigrants did not have a suicide pact. But what was happening at the time, in the early 1700s, was that Irish immigrants were not considered white. Because at the time, Ireland was a colony of Great Britain. And the Irish were not seen as being part as legitimate citizens of the British Empire. I tell this story because what happened next, just a few decades after that, in 1790, when the U.S. became a country, they established the first naturalization law on how you can become a citizen. The only way you could become a citizen of the U.S. at that time was if you were a free white person, which meant for Irish immigrants who were indentured servants, if they just paid off all their debts, they could become citizens. And I tell this story again because it's an example of how citizenship was used as a tool to divide working people. By saying that only someone white and free could become a citizen, African slaves and Irish immigrants were stopped from uniting together to form a country that would prioritize the rights of working people. This story is even more relevant for today because the racial implications of this story we see today. Today, when you look at Los Angeles, you'll see stories like my friend Henry, an African-American unemployed, who worked 15 years in the Van Nuys auto plant, and then suddenly the plant is shut down and was sent out of the country, and he's struggling to look for a job that's the equivalent to that job. And then he starts blaming the Mexican immigrant he sees on the street corner and saying, "That worker, that Mexican immigrant is driving the wages down, is driving our jobs down." And he starts blaming them. And then there's the story of my friend Mrs. Min, who works at a restaurant, Korean immigrant, undocumented. Her Latino co-workers are organizing a union, but she's afraid to stand up because she's afraid of being deported. And then we start seeing more stories of native-born workers blaming immigrants for the loss of good jobs. Then you see documented immigrant workers blaming undocumented workers for driving their wages down. And then we see this perpetual cycle of stories of division. And then these stories of division end up being exported globally. Where in South Korea, we see undocumented workers being pitted against documented workers. Where migrant workers are forced to register with the government and have to, for 3 years, only work for one employer and no one else. You look in Europe, where anti-immigrant hatred and sentiment starts to arise, and people blaming undocumented immigrants, legalized immigrants. And then when you start seeing all these stories of blame and division, in the backdrop, we see the largest concentration of wealth since the 1920s, globally and in the US, where we see the largest gap between rich and poor, between the global north and the global south, between working people in the US, between the top 1% in the US. And this larger story that starts to develop from the stories of Henry, the stories of Mrs. Min, the stories of many immigrant workers, whatever country it is, begin to converge to form a larger global story of migrant workers being exploited, working people being divided, as large corporations like Walmart get fat off profits, as working people grow hungry from the lesser benefits they receive. This larger global story demands that we re-examine what it means to mean international solidarity. This symposium is important because this is a space where we could begin to re-examine what does international solidarity mean. International solidarity is not about charity, but about strategy. International solidarity is not just about fighting for better wages, it's about building a global community. International solidarity is not just about one fight here and one fight there, but one larger social movement for justice for all people. And our immediate challenge is distance and language. And what I want to end with here to deal with this problem and challenge of language is to begin to break that. So can I have everyone stand up, please? And I need you to repeat back as loud as you can.
Si se puede!
Si se puede!
Si se puede!
Si se puede!
Union!
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 Maki baka!
Maki baka!
Maki baka!
Maki baka!
Tuesday!
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 Thank you, Mr. Doloro, for your powerful speech.
Okay. 오전에 저희 프로그램에서 이민자, 특히 이주 노동자의 미국에서의 현황을 알아보는 시간을 가졌습니다. 이제 좀 더 세계적인 시각의 문제점에 눈을 돌리겠습니다. 이주 이민자가 늘어나면서 국제 이주의 노동자에 대한 시각을 가져볼 필요성이 생겼습니다. 이 시간은 국제 이주 문제에 대한 발제를 해주실 세 분을 소개하겠습니다.
During our morning session, we had a chance to look at the current conditions of immigrants, and more specifically, immigrant workers in the U.S. Now, we would like to turn our attention to a more global point of view, and I believe that this, through this panel, it will be a time for us to re-examine what international solidarity really means, as Mr. Doloro stated.
예, 첫 번째로 한국에서 한국 민주노총 서울본부 정책기획국장으로 재임 중이신 김진혁 선생님께서 이주 노동자 조직에 대한 발제를 해주시겠고요. 두 번째로는 호주 시드니 민족교육문화원 회장이신 신준식 선생님께서 호주의 이민 조직에 관련한 내용을 발제해 주시고요. 마지막으로 아시아 이주 노동자 포럼 지역 디렉터로 계시는 윌리엄 고이스 씨가 세계적 이주 이민의 개요를 말씀해 주시겠습니다.
So for last panel, our first speaker will be Mr. Jinuk Kim. He's currently serving as a Director of Policy and Planning for Korean Confederation of Trade Unions since 2005. And the second speaker will be Junshik Shin from Australia. Mr. Shin is the Director, President, and the co-founder of the Korean Resource Center in Sydney, Australia. He educates and advocates for subcontracted Korean immigrant workers in the construction and tiling industries. And our last and final speaker will be William Goyce, Regional Coordinator of the Migrant Forum in Asia, a regional network of migrants organizations, NGOs, advocates, grassroots organizations, and trade unions.
Yeah. 안녕하세요. 네, 먼저 한국의 이주민 상황에 대해서 발표할 기회를 주셔서 감사하다는 말씀부터 드립니다. 제가 이야기할 순서는요, 한국의 이주민 현황, 그리고 한국 정부의 이주민 정책, 그리고 이주노동자 고용제도 이 순으로 말씀드리도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 한국의 이주민 상황인데요, 2007년에 한국에 체류하는 외국인은 약 100만 명입니다. 이 중에서 이주노동자는 약 50만 명으로 체류 외국인 중 47.1%를 차지하고 있습니다. 그리고 결혼 이민자는 11만 명으로서 10.4%를 차지하고 있습니다. 그 미등록 체류자는 22만 3천 명으로 전체 체류자 중 21%에 달하고 있습니다. 그리고 체류 이주민은 국적별로 보면 중국 동포를 포함해서 중국이 약 50만 명, 미국이 11만 2천 명, 베트남이 7만 1천 명, 필리핀과 태국이 각 5만 명, 그리고 네팔, 방글라데시, 인도 등으로 구성되어 있습니다. 결혼 이민자는 2002년도에는 2만 5천 명이었는데 2007년도에는 11만 명으로 급증했습니다. 이것은 한국의 결혼자 중에서 10%를 차지하는 숫자입니다. 그리고 국적별로 보면 중국, 베트남, 일본, 필리핀, 몽골 순입니다. 이어서 한국 정부의 이주민 정책에 대해서 말씀드리도록 하겠습니다. 한국은 1980년대까지는 인력 송출국이었습니다. 근데 87년도 이후에 유입국이 되었습니다. 그 배경을 말씀드리면 1987년도에 경제 호황이 발생하면서 또 동시에 대기업과 중소기업 간의 임금 격차가 커지게 됩니다. 이런 상황에서 중소업체에서 인력 부족 현상이 발생합니다. 그래서 자연스럽게 이주 노동자가 유입되기 시작했고 그리고 그 당시에는 대부분 관광비자로 입국해서 미등록 취업을 했습니다. 그러다가 91년도에 해외 현지 법인 연수생 제도 그리고 94년도에 산업 연수생 제도가 생기면서 합법적으로 이주 노동자가 들어오기 시작합니다. 또한 1990년대부터 결혼 이민자들이 증가하게 됩니다. 그것은 경제 발전에 따라서 이농현상이 발생하죠. 그러면서 농촌의 젊은 총각들이 배우자를 찾지 못하고 중국이나 동남아에서 배우자를 찾으면서 결혼 이민자가 발생하게 됩니다. 이거는 한국 사회가 저출산 고령화 사회가 되면서 적정한 인구를 유지하려는 한국 정부의 의도하고도 맞아떨어져서 결혼 이민자가 확대됩니다. 한국 정부의 이주 노동자 정책은 첫 번째는 국가 경쟁력을 강화하기 위해서 전문 기술 인력은 적극적으로 유치한다. 그리고 두 번째, 단순 노무 인력은 제한적으로 도입한다. 그리고 세 번째, 숙련 기능 인력은 선별적으로 영주를 허용하고, 네 번째, 외국 국적 동포에 대해서는 우선적으로 배려하는 정책을 취하는 겁니다. 한마디로 얘기하면 대상에 따라서 차별화 정책을 취하고 있습니다. 그리고 결혼 이민자에 대한 정책은 결혼 이민자 및 2세에 대해서 차별금지, 사회 적응 지원을 확대하고 사회 통합 정책을 취하고 있습니다. 이는 결혼 이민자에게 한국 사회에 대한 적응 및 통합을 요구하는 정책입니다. 그리고 재외동포에 대해서는 단순 노무 인력은 금지하면서 전문직 중심의 제1, 제2 동포에 대해서는 우대 정책을 계속적으로 취해 왔었습니다. 그러다가 최근에 중국이나 구소련 동포에 대해서도 재외동포 자격을 부여하는 것을 확대하고 있습니다. 이는 재외동포 간에 차별을 하고 또 재외동포하고 다른 국적의 이주노동자하고 차별을 하는 정책을 취하고 있는 것입니다. 그리고 마지막으로 미등록 이주노동자에 대해서는 제한적으로 이제 단순 인력을 들여오면서 순환구조로 갔습니다. 그래서 그 순환구조에서 벗어나는 미등록 이주노동자에 대해서는 단속 주방을 강화하고 이거를 효과적으로 하기 위해서 출입국 관리법을 개혁을 추진하고 있는 정책을 취하고 있습니다. 한마디로 한국의 이주민 정책을 요약하면 배제와 통합입니다. 그래서 재외동포와 결혼 이민자는 민족 내지 국민으로 포용을 하고 단순 노무 인력과 미등록 이주노동자들은 통제와 관리의 대상으로 배제를 하는 정책을 취하고 있습니다. 이제 한국의 이주노동자 고용 정책에 대해서 말씀드리도록 하겠습니다. 91년도까지는 한국 정부의 이주노동자 정책이 없었습니다. 그러다가 이주노동자들이 계속 미등록 이주노동자들이 발생하고 91년도에 4만 명을 넘어서기 시작하면서 한국 정부는 관련 제도의 필요성을 절감하고 그러면서 91년도에 해외 현지 법인 연수생 제도, 94년도에 산업 연수생 제도를 도입합니다. 연수생 제도를 도입하게 된 목적은 미등록 이주노동자들을 대해서 미등록 이주노동자들을 연수생으로 대체해서 불법 체류자 문제와 인력 부족 문제를 동시에 해결하겠다는 그런 목적으로 시행이 됐습니다. 근데 산업 연수생 제도에서 연수생은 노동자로서의 법적 지위가 없었습니다. 그렇기 때문에 노동법 적용이 되지 않았고 직장의 이동의 자유가 없었습니다. 그리고 산재보험이나 의료보험 같은 사복지 혜택에서 배제가 되었습니다. 따라서 저임금과 장시간 노동을 강요받았고 폭언이나 폭행 등 인권침해, 여권 압류 같은 인권침해가 발생을 했습니다. 그리고 미등록 이주노동자들보다 산업연수생의 임금이 훨씬 더 적었습니다. 따라서 산업연수생들이 작업장을 이탈해서 미등록 신분이 되었습니다. 그런 과정에 미등록 노동자들이 폭발적으로 증가하게 돼서 2002년도에는 28만 9천 명의 미등록 이주노동자들이 발생했는데 이는 전체 이주노동자의 80%에 해당하는 수치입니다. 이렇게 되자 한국 정부는 이런 문제를 해결하기 위해서 2003년도 11월에 소위 얘기하는 고용허가제를 실시하게 됩니다. 고용허가제의 핵심 내용을 보면 입국한 날로부터 3년간 취업할 수 있습니다. 그리고 취업한 후에 출국하게 되면 6개월이 지나서 재입국을 할 수 있는 자격이 부여가 됩니다. 그리고 예외적인 경우를 제외하고는 여전히 작업장 이동의 자유가 없습니다. 그리고 1년을 초과하는 계약을 할 수 없습니다. 그러니까 3년간 체류를 하지만 1년마다 계약을 갱신하게 됩니다. 이 고용허가제는 산업연수생보다 진전된 제도이긴 하나 작업장 이동의 자유가 없고 계약기간이 1년으로 제한되어 있기 때문에 사용자에게 예속될 수뿐이 없는 제도입니다. 이에 따라서 여전히 이주노동자들은 미등록 이주노동자들은 저임금 장시간 노동에 시달렸는데요. 예를 들면 2005년도에 이런 이주노동자들의 평균 임금이 97만 5천 원이었습니다. 이는 한국인 노동자 임금의 대략 40% 정도 수준뿐이 되지 않습니다. 그리고 월 280시간의 장시간 노동을 했습니다. 주로 따지면 70시간이 가깝죠. 예, 그런 장시간 노동과 노예 노동을 강요받았습니다. 이러한 열악한 상황에서 한국의 이주노동자들은 이주노동자 권리를 위해서 투쟁을 전개합니다. 그리고 이주노동자 지원단체나 한국의 노동사회단체도 함께 투쟁을 전개를 하게 됩니다. 그리고 미등록 이주노동자의 합법화와 그 다음에 합법비자 쟁취를 위한 고용허가제가 아닌 노동허가제를 요구하면서 지금 현재 계속 싸우고 있습니다. 이런 과정에서 2005년도 5월 달에 이주노동자들은 자신들의 독자적인 조직 이주노동조합을 설립하게 됩니다. 현재 한국 정부는 이주노동조합을 인정치 않고 있습니다. 고등법원까지 이주노동조합에 대한 합법 판결을 받았는데요. 한국 정부는 현재 대법원에 제소를 해놓고 있는 상황입니다. 그리고 지금 여전히 미등록 이주 노동자가 계속 확대되면서 한국 정부는 이주 노동자에 대한 단속을 강화하고 있습니다. 지금 현재 한국의 미등록 이주 노동자들은 22만 명인데요. 이거를 15만 명으로 줄이겠다고 합니다. 그 줄이기 위해서 단속 추방을 강화하고 있는데 이런 단속 추방을 피해서 달아나다가 건물 옥상에서 추락사하거나 아니면 지하철에서 자살을 하거나 아니면 단속 추방 당해서 외국인 보호소에서 화재로 죽거나 하는 것들을 여러분들도 언론 보도를 통해서 접하셨을 겁니다. 그리고 또 한국 정부는 이주 노동자에 대한 탄압을 아주 강화하고 있습니다. 이주 노조가 2005년도 5월 달에 만들어졌는데요. 그동안 지도부가 세 번 바뀌었습니다. 상기 지도부까지 구성이 됐었는데 2005년도에 1기 지도부가 표적 단속을 돼서 강제 추방을 당했고요. 2007년도 11월 달에 2기 지도부가 역시 표적 단속돼서 강제 추방을 당했습니다. 그리고 바로 얼마 전이죠. 바로 올해 2008년도 5월 달에 역시 단속 추방돼서 상기 지도부가 강제 추방을 당했습니다. 그럼에도 불구하고 한국의 이주노동자와 노동사회단체는 이주노동자 권리를 위해 지금 이 순간에도 투쟁을 계속하고 있습니다. 이 신자주의 세계화 과정에서 이주노동자 문제는 필연적으로 발생할 수뿐이 없습니다. 그런 과정에서 한국의 동지들은 이 문제를 일국적 차원에서 해결할 수 없는 문제다라고 보고 국제적 연대 강화를 위해서 지금 노력을 하고 있습니다. 오늘 심포지움은 미국을 비롯해서 각국의 이주노동자 운동을 배우고 함께 국제적 연대를 모색하는 아주 소중한 기회가 될 것 같습니다. 이 자리를 마련해 주신 동지들께 다시 한번 감사의 말씀을 전하며 이상 마치도록 하겠습니다. 예, 감사합니다.
잘 안 보이는 것 같네. 먼저 말씀드리고 이게 준비가 되면 계속 하도록 하겠습니다. 첫째, 제가 말씀드릴 내용은 호주 이민 정책이 1990년도에부터 지금까지 어떤 식으로 변화가 되고 있는가를 간략하게 말씀을 드리고, 그 다음에 두 번째로 그 영주권 이민자 현황은 어떤 식으로 진행되고 있는가, 그 다음에 세 번째 오늘 많이 이야기가 되고 있는 이주노동자들이라고 할 수 있는 임시이민자들과 서류미비자들의 현황은 어떻게 되고 있고, 그 다음에 그 사람들의 임금 형태는 어떤 식으로 지금 진행되고 있는가, 그리고 제가 시간이 남으면 저희들이 했던 캠페인을 몇 가지 소개해 드리도록 하겠습니다. 아, 그러면 된 것 같네요. 그러면 여기에 그 앞에 보시는 대로 1970년대만 하더라도 대부분 정책 자체가 인구 증가를 목적으로 정책이 많이 진행됐습니다. 그러던 것이 1970년대부터 1990년 중반기까지는 이제 그 대개 영주권자를 영입을 해서 기술 문제를 해결하는 그런 형태로 진행됐는데, 이제 지금부터 제가 말씀드리는 그 중심적인 내용은 뭐냐면 1990년 중반대부터 지금까지 진행된 이민 정책은 노동시장의 유연화 정책의 하부 정책 정도로 해서 임시 이민자들을 많이 영입하는 그런 형태로 진행됐습니다. 그래서 여기에 그림에 보시면 1995년, 1996년까지 있죠? 거기까지 보면은 그 영주권 이민자들과 임시 이민자들의 숫자가 그렇게 많이 차이가 안 나는데, 1995년, 96년부터는 그 임시 비자를 받고 그 호주에 들어오는 사람들이 상당히 많이 늘어나죠. 33만 명이 늘어났고, 그 다음에는 66만 8천 명에다가 그 다음에는 74만 정도, 그래서 임시 이민자들이 굉장히 많이 늘어나는 그런 형태의 이민 정책을 갖게 되었다. 그것이 이제 하나의 특징이고요. 그 다음에 그 다음으로 그래서 특히나 또 하나의 특징은 뭐냐면, 그전에는 그 이민 분포를, 이민자들을 받을 때, 영주권 이민을 받을 때 기술 이민, 그 다음에 그 가족 이민, 그 다음에 인도주의적인 차원의 이민들이 어느 정도 밸런스를 맞췄는데, 1996년부터 시작해서는 이제 그것이 기술 이민의 중심으로 그 중심이 바뀌기 시작했습니다. 그래서 1996년, 97년에 23%가 기술 이민이었다면, 2005년, 2006년에는 그래서 그 2005년, 2006년도에는 50%가 기술 이민이 됐고, 그 다음에 또 새롭게 바뀐 그 정책, 요번에 노동당 정부에서 새롭게 바뀐 정책에서 보면 정책에서 보면은 이제 기술 이민이 70%로 늘어나고 있습니다. 그래서 호주 그 이민 정책이 굉장히 기술 이민 정책이다. 그 다음에 두 번째는 임시 이민 정책으로 바뀌어가는 상황에 있습니다. 그래서 이제 지금 그러면 영주권을 받고 호주에 들어오는 사람들의 그 나라의 분포를 보면 제일 많이 오는 나라가 영국, 그 다음에 뉴질랜드, 인디아, 중국, 필리핀 이런 순서인데, 여기에 1985년부터 86년, 95년, 96년, 2005년, 2006년 있죠? 그러면은 대개 그 큰 흐름은 변화가 없이 영주권을 받고 오는 나라들은 큰 흐름이 변화가 없는데, 여기 수단이라는 나라가 굉장히 75위에서 지금 7위로 됐죠? 그것은 수단에서 난민들이 많이 들어오기 때문에 변화된 상황을 빼고 나면 거의 비슷한 수준으로 영국, 뉴질랜드, 인디아, 중국, 필리핀 이런 순으로 영식 이민자들이 많이 들어오고 있다. 그렇게 볼 수 있습니다. 이것도 다시 한번 도표로 보기 쉽게 한번 정리를 한 건데요. 1996년, 95년부터 96년하고 2005년 사이를 보면 이 임시 이민자들이 급속하게 늘어나는 걸 볼 수 있죠. 그걸 보여드리기 위해서 이 그림을 하나 보여드렸습니다. 자, 그러면 다시 한번 좀 숫자로다가 좀 더 세부적으로 살펴보면, 그 임시 이민자라는 것이 임시 이민 비자를 받고 호주 와서 일할 수 있는 사람들을 말합니다. 일할 수 있는 사람 중에는 학생들도 20시간 일할 수 있기 때문에 노동자로 분류될 수도 있다. 그래서 학생도 집어넣고, 그 다음에 워킹 홀리데이 거기 메이커라고 나온 것은 뭐냐면 그 31세 미만들, 그러니까 18살부터 30세까지 젊은이들이 호주 와서 농장이라든가 건설 노동 시장에서 1년 동안 일할 수 있습니다. 그 다음에 농장 가서 3개월을 일하면 1년 더 연장을 할 수 있어서 2년 동안 일할 수 있는 사람들이 워킹 홀리데이 그 비자를 받은 사람들이고, 그 다음에
temporary business entrance라고 쓴 것은 그 워킹 비자입니다. 일명 457 비자라고 하는데 이 사람들은 기술 이민, 임시 기술 이민이죠. 들어와서 호주에서 짧게는 6개월부터 4년까지 기술 그 고용주 초청 임시 비자라고 해야 되나요? 고용주 밑에서 일을 하고 4년이 넘으면 또 4년을 연장할 수도 있고 그 중에 영주권을 신청해서 퍼머넌트 레지던트가 되는 경우도 있습니다. 그래서 이제 457 비자의 특징을 다시 한번 좀 말씀을 드리면 아까 조금 전에 말씀드린 대로 템포러리 그 비자인데 거기서 존 하워드 정권 그 보수당 정권부터 시작된 비자고요. 그다음에 그것은 호주의 그 기술 부족을 짧은 시간 내에 해결하기 위해서 만들어진 비자고 그다음에 그것은 아까도 말씀드린 고용주가 고용주 초청에 의해서 이루어진다. 그다음에 아까 말씀드린 대로 30살 31세 미만 30살까지 젊은이 들어오는 비율 그 사람들은 주로 미숙련공들 그러니까 그 우리나라로 말하면 단순 노동자들이죠. 그다음에 31세고 그다음에 1996년에는 5만 2천 명이 들어왔는데 2006년, 2007년에는 13만 명이 넘는 사람들이 들어왔고 특히나 한국은 1996년에는 561명이 들어왔지만 이제 작년 해계년도, 전년도 해계년도에서는 2만 8,562명이라는 상당히 많은 젊은이들이 호주의 워킹 홀리데이 비자를 받고 들어와 있습니다. 들어온 나라들을 좀 분포를 해보면 여기 보시는 대로 영국이 제일 많고 그 다음에 코리아가 두 번째로 많죠. 이런 여기에 그 포함되는 나라들은 호주에서 아무 나라나 그 워킹 홀리데이 비자를 안 주고 호주에 들어와도 오버스테이를 안 할 수 있는 나라들을 중심으로 해서 주기 때문에 한 10개가 조금 넘는 나라가 워킹 홀리데이 비자를 받을 수 있습니다. 여기는 이제 한국 분들이 호주에 들어와 있는 걸 좀 비교하게 해서 이걸 보여드리려고 하는데요. 한국 분들이 영주권을 타고 여기 퍼머넌트 마이그런트와 2,000명 조금 넘습니다. 그것은 이제 밖에서 들어오신 분들 안에서 457이라든가 학생비자를 갖고 있다가 영주권을 딴 사람들이 한 2,000명 그래서 한 4,500에서 5,000명 정도가 매년 영주권을 받고 있고 나머지들은 굉장히 그 템포러리 비자들이 많죠. 학생이 26,000명 워킹홀리데이가 아까 말씀드린 28,000명 그다음에 그 고용주 초청 임시 비자를 받는 사람들 28,000명에서 한 6만 명 정도가 호주에 이민자로다가 매년 그 분포되는 형태입니다. 그다음에 간단하게 그 서류비 비자에 대해서 말씀드리도록 하겠습니다. 서류비 비자가 생기는 원인은 첫째 정식 이민을 오려면은 영어도 좀 해야 되고 그다음에 포인트 그러니까 어느 정도 점수를 맞아야 되기 때문에 그거에 맞추기 어려운 사람들 그다음에 그 고용주의 초청을 못 받은 사람들 그다음에 30세까지의 젊은이가 아닌 사람들은 그런 방법으로 정식적인 방법으로 못 들어오기 때문에 다른 제3의 길을 택해서 들어오기 때문에 그 서류 미비자들이 생긴다 이렇게 볼 수 있습니다. 그래서 서류 미비자들을 두 가지로 분류하면 오버스테이가 된 사람들이 한 4만 6천 명 그다음에 오버스테이는 아니지만 뭐 관광비자를 갖고 일을 한다든지 다른 비자를 갖고 일하는 사람들이 그 나머지에서 한 6만 명 정도가 호주 정부에서는 6만 명 정도를 그 언도큐멘티드 워커들 그러니까 그 서류 미비자들로 한 6만에서 왔다 갔다 하는 거를 갖다 조정을 하는 것 같아요. 많으면은 좀 단속을 심하게 하고 적으면은 단속을 좀 심하게 하지 않게 해서 6만 명 정도를 유지해 나가는 것 같습니다. 그래서 오버스테이가 많은 나라가 좀 이상하게도 제일 많은 나라가 미국 사람들이 제일 많이 오버스테이가 제일 많습니다. 그 다음에 중국, 영국 이런 식으로 있는데 요 숫자는 대개 호주에 많이 들어오는 사람들이 많은 나라가 오버스테이도 많은 것 같습니다. 미국에서 영주권을 받고 호주 오는 사람들은 많이 없지만 관광비자라든가 그런 걸 받고 들어오는 사람들이 많아요. 그래서 미국 사람들이 많이 들어오는 것만큼 또 오버스테이도 제일 많은 것 같습니다. 그래서 이제 자꾸 임금 문제만 말씀드리고 오늘 요거 저거서 맞춰야 될 것 같은데 그 임시 비자를 받은 사람들이라든가 그다음에 그 젊은이들 워킹 홀리데이 비자를 받은 사람들의 그 단순 노동자의 임금을 호주하고 비교하면 호주의 임금은 굉장히 그 잘 정비가 되어 있습니다. 직종마다 산별마다 최저 임금이 정해져 있고 그다음에 그런 것들이 굉장히 그 잘된 나라 중에 하나인데 이제 그래서 여기를 비교해 보면 여기 이쪽에 있는 거는 호주 기준에 따라서 줘야 되는 임금이고 이쪽에 있는 거는 한국의 그 젊은이를 비롯한 단순 노동자들이 받는 임금입니다. 청소를 하는 사람이 호주 기준은 18불, 그 다음에 숍에서 일하면 19불, 그 다음에 식당에서 일하면 16불, 그 다음에 컨스트럭션 워크는 힘들게 일하기 때문에 20불, 21불 되죠. 근데 진짜 받는, 우리 그 사람들이 받는 것은 청소하는 경우에 11불에서 12불, 그 다음에 숍에서 일하면 한 8불 정도, 레스토랑에서 일하면 8불에서 9불, 건설 현장에서 일하는 사람은 12불, 이런 식으로 받고 있습니다. 이 문제는 약간 설명을 드려야 되는데, 이쪽에 그 호주 기준에서는 세금을 15% 포함한 금액입니다. 그래서 여기 대개 그 한국 사람들은 캐시인, 그러니까 현찰로 돈을 받기 때문에 조금 정확하게 여기 딱 맞는 건 아니지만 대개 이런 식으로 임금 차이가 많이 납니다. 또 하나의 한국 커뮤니티의 특징을 말씀드리면 단순 노동자와 그 다음에 기술을 가진 사람의 임금이 엄청나게 많이 차이가 납니다. 호주 기준에서는 몇 퍼센트 차이가 안 나는데 한국 기준에서는 엄청나게 차이가, 그걸 설명을 드리면 예를 들면 완전히 단순 노동자가 하루에 100불, 굉장히 기술이 좋은 사람은 하루에 300불, 350불, 그래서 막 300배가 차이는 거죠. 한 300배가 차이가 나는, 엄청나게 임금 차이가 많이 나는 게 코리안 커뮤니티 현상입니다. 아마 한국 스타일이 호주에 그대로 이렇게 이동해와서 그런 게 아닌가 그렇게 생각을 하는데, 한국 상황은 제가 정확하게 모르기 때문에 하여튼 그런 거 아닌가 그렇게 생각합니다. 근데 이거는 호주 기준이거든요. 그래서 호주는 단순 타일을 하는 경우에 단순 노동자가 19불이면 기술자가 21불, 49불에서 별 차이가 안 난다. 다만 코리안 커뮤니티는 엄청나게 많이 차이 난다, 이렇게 말씀드릴 수 있습니다. 이 정도 말씀드리고 나머지는 워크숍 때 또 말씀을 드리고 같이 토론하도록 하겠습니다. 고맙습니다.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to begin by saying thank you for inviting me to be part of this. And I think it has been important for me, because in my mind, when I saw that first video clipping this morning, it raised a lot of questions for me of the work that we are doing back home. Just to introduce myself, I am William Goyes from the Migrant Forum in Asia. It's a regional network that means South Asia, Southeast Asia, and East Asia that works on the issues of migrant workers. Listening from the talk this morning, and this is where I want to base my presentation on, because this session is about challenges in building a global village. And from the first session this morning, when people were recalling the events around May 18th, one of the things that was said was, and I think Jin Suk mentioned that part of her formation was that people at that time were aware of the different struggles, and people participated in the different struggles of freedom or democracy or liberation. There was this sense at that time among people who wanted to see change and wanted to see peace. Thinking of that time, the 80s, and looking at our present time now, what is the deficit? What is missing? We have, in a sense, international solidarity. We have, in a sense, global village. But somewhere, I think, the passion that we saw in that slide of this morning, that seems to be missing. At least I've had a sense of that. And I look at our own work today, I see that as well. What would be the challenges then for us today in building global solidarity? How do we go about it? You heard just a little while ago the situation of, while we are even talking about undocumented workers and immigrant rights in this country, for this particular Korean community that is US-based, how do you look at the struggle of migrant workers in Korea, the undocumented migrant workers in Korea? Even as we are sitting here now, there is a crackdown, there is a clamp down on migrant workers in Korea. You've heard that leaders of the undocumented migrant workers unions have been deported just in the last 2 weeks. So how do we, as a Korean community based here in the US, how do we link up with that struggle is something I think we would have to ask ourselves. And I'm putting that across because I think this is, in my own work as regional coordinator of the Migrant Forum in Asia, this is something that we have begun to see more and more working to the advantage. This non-formation or this international solidarity not coming together in the possible ways it could is something that is working to the advantage of those who would like to exploit labor and migration. One of the challenges that we face within the Migrant Forum Asia is just organizing migrant workers. Aside from the regular challenges of that they don't have day off, or it's difficult to reach to them, it's difficult to go to their sites, they are in work areas that are not easily accessible to populations, they are in far out places. Aside from those kind of structural issues of which make it difficult to organize migrant workers, there are other issues as well. And it is something that we've got to be able to see and understand and then develop some kind of ways in working with migrant workers. For example, one of the issues that we face is when migrant workers themselves do not come together in the struggle. Very often this plays out where you find that it's difficult for migrant workers to see their struggle as one struggle. And I'll give you this example. A number of, say for example, countries like Malaysia or Singapore, or Japan, which are receiving countries within the Asian region, there are the different migrant worker populations. There are the Bengalis from Bangladesh, there are Indians, Pakistanis, Sri Lankans, Filipinos, Indonesians. But migrant workers like us carry with them certain preconceptions about people and certain biases as well. And so sometimes migrant workers, even if they are in the same sector, whether it is domestic work, whether it is cleaning, whether it is working in the factory, whatever work they are involved in, they carry with them sometimes what they hear of the other. And that creates a natural gap, a bridge, where they don't want to interact and where they don't build solidarity. And so it becomes very difficult, even if they are facing the same problems, to be able to come together and struggle against that problem. And for us, that is an issue that we have to see how to work with, because it's and this plays out also in this current global system, the market system, which brings in migrant workers. For example, you would have in places like Singapore, for example, in the domestic work sector, you would find a Filipina maid being as a domestic worker being paid, say, 400 Singaporean dollars a month. But then you have the Indonesian worker who comes in and she's willing to accept a pay of 350. And then you have a Vietnamese who would come in and say, okay, I'll go for 200. And then you have a Sri Lankan who comes in and says, she will work for 150. And you have this situation growing in a lot of the host countries. There is no minimum wage in places like Singapore. So the government says it's a market thing. So let the market decide on the wages. And so the market decides on the wages and people are put into those categories. So any Sri Lankan domestic worker coming into Singapore will be paid 150. And when wages and people are categorized in that way, then the Filipino domestic worker who's getting 400 Singaporean dollars in Singapore doesn't see herself in the same category as the Sri Lankan who is getting 150. And so it's difficult for them to see what is their joint struggle together. Whereas if they were, and even the Filipina would be getting a low wage. But just because her wage is higher than that of the Sri Lankan, she sees herself in a different category. And so if there is a struggle, you would get this kind of division within the migrant groups. And how do you work with that? How do you bring out a bigger picture? And how do you say this is a worker struggle together, or this is a common struggle, and this is something that is to our benefit, and this will change? These are some of the challenges that we have to work with when we deal with the migrant workers in host countries. This is in any host country and for example, in Korea, there was a distinction at a certain time between the Chinese Koreans as migrant workers in Korea and the other migrant workers from other nationalities that were in Korea. So how do you build solidarity? It's a challenging question. And we've got to look into that. The other issue that we find, and in Migrant Forum Asia, our experience has been, we have not allowed migration to be a sectoral issue. It's not an issue of a certain number of people or a certain sector. And we have therefore tried to make migration a gender issue. So we have gone to the feminist networks and said to them, what is your position on the migration, migrant workers issue, largely women workers who are in the domestic work sector. What is your position on that? We have gone to the trade network, civil society in the trade sector that is looking at the WTO and anti-WTO mobilizations, and asked them, how do you see migration, and dialogue with them on that. To the development networks, to the peasants and agricultural and farmers networks, what are the linkages? And to the trade unions, what are the linkages between what NGOs and civil society organizations working on migration? How can we collaborate on this? Because for a long time also, we were working either sectorally or we were working with our own lens on the issue. And for us, it has been one of our major achievements has been in the last years is to be able to forge these kind of alliances with the trade unions, with the gender networks, with the trade networks, with the development networks, to be able to see that our struggle is a common struggle. And it is only in looking at our issues with a cross-sectoral lens that we will actually be able to form some kind of alliance, some kind of solidarity. And I think that is the deficit that is one of the deficits today that we have to be able to see how to transcend or how to overcome. I will leave it at that, just announcing that this year in Manila is the Global Forum on Migration and Development. Today, governments are putting this new spin as if on trying to sanitize the discussion and say migration and development. But they talk a lot of migration and development, but from a perspective that does not uphold the rights and dignity of human beings, the labor and human rights of and dignity of human beings. And this is something that we try to emphasize. And this is, the governments will be doing this migration and development discourse every year. For the first time, it's coming to Asia. This is only the second one. And we hope that there would be, and then there are, we know that there will be Korean activists coming over to Manila to join our struggle in that, in trying to put to this government, intergovernment-led discussions, trying to bring a human and labor rights perspective to it. You can look up our website for this, and I'm sure there's material available elsewhere also on this. Thank you.
Yes. 이제 발제해 주신 세 분을 모시고 간단한 질의응답 시간을 갖도록 하겠습니다.
We'll have a quick Q&A session with our presenters. I was told that we only have about 5 minutes.